text today is from John chapter 20, verses 11 through 18. And this story takes place right after Jesus' tomb has been rolled away. And this is the first person who gets to share the good news about Jesus. Now Mary Magdalene, stood outside the tomb crying. And as she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They've taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they put him." And at this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. And he asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it that you're looking for?" And thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you put him, and I will go get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. And Jesus says, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to the Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," as she told them the things that he had said to them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. If you can't tell, I've got a cold. We're going to work our way through it today and see how far this goes. I just want to spend a couple minutes today reflecting on this story, share with you some challenges to the idea of women in ministry, and then I'm going to do my best to actually make a case why we in this church believe that every single gender is fully available to use their gifts that God's given them in any office whatsoever. And so we're going to talk about that in just a minute. But before I get too far, let's talk about this story for half a second. What's going on in this little section from John chapter 20? Where does it take place? In a garden. Where else do we know about a famous garden in the Bible? In Genesis. That's right. The Bible starts in the garden, and here we have a story in another garden context. In the first garden story, we have Adam and Eve. In this one, you have Jesus and Mary. In the first garden story, the woman makes a terrible one. In this particular story in John chapter 20, one of the things that we see God doing is redeeming what had happened in Genesis chapter 2, where God says, you know what, we're not going to let the fall of creation be the last word that happens in it. Instead, what's going to happen is I'm going to do something new. And this is such an unlikely moment in human history, where the God of the universe is raised from the dead, and the very first person to meet God is who? Now, back in ancient Near East, especially in first century Judaism, if you were a woman and your job was to go and deliver news to someone, it was illegal to do so if you couldn't be trusted. So if you were a woman, you weren't allowed to testify in court because your testimony was invalid, because they would say the source isn't reliable or trustworthy.
Right.
And so how crazy
this is supposed to be input.
That the person that Jesus chooses to be the one to be the very first evangelist, proclamator of the gospel of the risen Lord, is a powerful statement from Jesus that upside down flips the course of human history. From the very beginning, Jesus was more inclusive and radical in his approach to who he would allow in his kingdom than we could have ever imagined. And today what I want to do is just walk through Jesus' story of the radical inclusivity of women and empowerment of them for the proclamation of the gospel. But before we do that, there's a few things we should recognize. And that's statistics. Because when it comes to how many women in our world are actually proclaiming the gospel, the statistics in an ordered way, this would be in the form of a pastor or an elder or a teacher within the church. Only 11% of American congregations have female leaders, and that includes pastors and elders and deacons. Only 11%. 93% of pastors in America are men, and I think that number might have been higher since this came out. The majority of congregants, ironically, are female. So the church is composed of more women than men, even though the percentage of men in leadership is just off the charts higher. Roman Catholics, the Eastern Orthodox, Mormons, and most Protestants, especially Baptists and non-denominational churches, do not allow women to be pastors, to be elders, or to be deacons in their churches. There was a big split in the Presbyterian Church several decades ago over this issue and how it should be addressed and what should be done. And so within Lutherans, within Presbyterians, within Methodists, there's always all these little splits over these issues all throughout the decades. I'll keep going now. Pope Francis, was recently asked whether or not women were ever likely to become priests or to be ordained as leaders in the church. And initially, he had hinted a long time ago, very early this year, that it might be possible. But later on, he retracted his statements and came down even harder and set a statement where he said he likely thinks that it's the eternal decree of God that only men can become priests. This is actually kind of interesting because I did not know this. It wasn't until 1956, that the very first woman was ordained in the Presbyterian Church. So I grew up in a situation where I was used to having women in ministry being surrounded by co-leaders who were women. But if you were a generation before me, this is how new this idea is in the church today. It wasn't until the 50s that women were allowed to be pastors or leaders in the Presbyterian Church. Just a couple more stories. I was amazed by this as well. Where I went to seminary, women weren't even admitted to go to Princeton University until 1969. That blows my mind considering the context in which I grew up. Of course, women's suffrage and the right to vote came in 1920, but the church reacted far later than that. So that's the world in which we inhabit. And I go so far as to say, when you factor in all the Eastern Orthodox and all the Roman Catholics and everyone else, this is just a guess, and I don't know if it's right, but at least 90% to 95% of the Christian world does not allow women to be in leadership. That's a crazy idea to me, but I want to just spend a moment today reflecting on that. And I'll start with just a personal story from my life. I grew up on the West Coast, which means we're kind of hippies a little bit, just by birth, because that's the way it is, where you grow up wearing Birkenstocks and sandals and, live by the mountains. So that's what I grew up with. That's the way it was. And when the church that I grew up in always had male and female leaders, that's the context in which I grew up. It had a male pastor for the two when I was growing up there. But my dad did something that was very unusual. He was on a pastor nominating committee. It's one of the most difficult things you can ever do if you're in a Presbyterian church, is be a part of a committee that calls the next pastor. There's a lot of pressure on you, right? Like, what if you mess up, like this church did, with me? There's a lot of options, right? You're stuck for a long time. And I remember my dad, he went to like dozens and dozens and dozens of meetings, trying to look for their next pastor, trying to find someone who would be the next person to lead their congregation into the future. They ended up calling a single woman to be their pastor. And I remember my dad thinking, because my dad was kind of a traditional guy. He wasn't the most progressive kind of person who you all meet. But I remember him coming home one day and said, "Chris, we just did the craziest thing." And I'm like, "What?" He goes, I don't know why, but I felt like the Spirit was leading us to call this person that I just totally wouldn't have expected to be involved in our church. And I remember how like astounded his mind was, but how clear he was and how he felt like it was God's move at work in the life of the church. And so that's the context in which I grew up. And another thing I should say is another part of my story, which is maybe different than some of yours, is my wife and I are very unique in that we kind of do church together. I was not always the pastor in our relationship. And so when we started dating, Jen and I were of the mind and heart, where as a couple, we saw each other as complete equals in everything that we did. And so we share all of our resources and our finances. When it comes to raising the kids, that's all on her, but I'm just teasing them. It's like 100%. She wouldn't claim I'm meeting her halfway, but I'm trying my best. But everything that we do in our relationship tries to be partners 100% in everything that we do. And so when we started out, I was a grad student, and so she was my sugar mama. She was the one making money for our family while I was still in school, and I enjoyed that. And this is what was interesting, too, is she was a pastor. She was a youth pastor in the church. She went to seminary with me as well, and so she was the first one. And I always viewed myself and my identity during those years for me, is I was the youth pastor's husband. She was the one that had the authority and the one that worked in church, and I was the one who had to go on church retreats with junior hires and stay up all night and be miserable. Like, that was like my calling in life, to have this outside thing. She was the church one. So it was kind of a really weird fit for the two of us. When I took this job and was called here to this church, as she wasn't the one working in a church. So Jen and I go both ways. We've been back and forth. I'm more of a breadwinner now, although I can tell you this, it means nothing to our family in terms of who does what or makes what. We're just equals and we share everything that we have. But that's my background. I didn't grow up in a situation where men and women were equal. But I know that's not the case of the majority, probably, of folks here today, where you grew up with either a system of patriarchy that was a lot more dominant or strong or prevalent. And I also live in the Latin American context of those churches. Men and women often view each other in very different ways than the way that I grew up. that's the context in which we all inhabit. And it's important to recognize how you grew up and where you came from. And I'm not saying my way is necessarily the right way, but what we want to do today is just take a moment to reflect on what does the Bible say about the proclamation of women and whether or not they're called to be a part of God's leadership in the church. So I just want to walk you through something really quick. This is only going to take a couple minutes, but I hope that you enjoy it. I actually took some time this week and looked at the scriptures and read a bunch of books and websites. And I just came up with a short list, there's a lot more than this, of different moments in the Bible where we see snapshots of where God was empowering women to be leaders in the church. So I'll just start here. We just read here in John chapter 20, where Mary Magdalene is the first person to see the risen Lord and is told to share that with the disciples. In chapter 2 of the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 26, there's a mandate that's given where it says, go and subdue the earth and name all the animals and build culture and do all these things. The cultural mandate or the main mandate that was given to Adam and Eve was given to whom? Adam and Eve. It wasn't given to just one or the both of them. And so God's first command in the very first beginning of the Bible isn't to one particular race or gender or sex or anything like that. It was to the totality of the people that were there. In Exodus, we find Miriam. Miriam is the sister of Moses and Aaron, and it describes her as a prophetess. And she's even given an entire chapter in the Bible where she gets to sing a song and prophesy about Israel. And the Bible tells her, remember, if you're a prophet, what that means is you are empowered and equipped by the Holy Spirit to proclaim the good news of God. And so here we have a prophetess, Miriam, the sister of Moses and Aaron, very early on in Exodus, proclaiming the good news of the gospel. In Judges chapter 4 and 5, there was Deborah. Deborah was one of the judges of Israel. She was one of the ones that says that led them in battle and gave them great victory. And so you think of the Bible as this very patriarchal text, and in many ways it was, because that was the culture in which it was written. But in addition to that, it never hesitates to mention the one exceptions to that rule. And here you have a female president of Israel leading them in battle. She's one of the generals. So that's a pretty cool story if you want to read about that. Esther, I don't know if you know her story, but Esther was a Jewish woman who became the queen and ended up rescuing all her people. She's seen as a hero among the Jewish people because she saved them from total annihilation and extinction. So that's a pretty amazing story. And we'll just skip ahead. I'm just skipping all over here. But in Luke chapter 8, verses 1 through 3, it says that Jesus had, this is a quote, had with him his disciples as well as the women. And so even though it says that his disciples were there, it never hesitates to say, and the women were there too. You have to remember that in Jesus' culture, it would have been like almost too radical to go where people needed to go. Jesus always meets us where we're at and takes baby steps. But how cool of a baby step was it to say he gathered the 12 and had all the women around with him? Names of Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Susanna, and quote, many others were with him as well. So whenever Jesus walked around, we often picture just the 12 disciples, right? But most likely it wasn't like that. When Jesus went around, he had the 12 disciples with him, but there were women with him as well. And so let me give you another example. You know one story where the disciples are sitting at Jesus' feet, and Mary and Martha are there, and there's this little fight between Mary and Martha, where Martha's off in the kitchen saying, hey, Mary, you need to quit sitting and listening with the disciples at his feet and come help me out with stuff in the kitchen to get everything ready. And Jesus says, whoa, 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 Martha, slow down. She has every right to be. So he slows everyone down and says, she's chosen the better path. What a radical statement of Jesus. I'll just keep going because there's a lot more. Jesus was radically countercultural. Women were included in many of the parables, like the lost coin, the widow, the unjust judge, the 10 bridesmaids, the woman with chronic bleeding, the woman caught in the act of adultery. So there's all these stories where women play a very prominent role in the kingdom of God that Jesus is describing. Ironically, Pilate's wife was the only one who tried to defend Jesus at his trial. So there you have a woman that's stepping right up to the plate and saying, you shouldn't kill this man. She has a dream that says, I would take a step back if I were you. Women were the only ones who remained with Jesus after his disciples fled before his crucifixion. So we think that there were women that were there trying to meet his needs, praying for him and caring for him in ways that they could. At Pentecost, it says that in the upper room where the disciples were, that there were women there as well. We often like to think of just a bunch of dudes doing all these things. But whenever we talk about the early people in the Bible, there was almost never a situation where it was just guys, but it was always a mixed crowd. Again, I can't emphasize enough, for this time and place, this was extremely radical. When Peter gives his Pentecost sermon immediately after the Holy Spirit comes, he quotes Joel the prophet, where it talks about how in the final days when the Holy Spirit comes, both men and women will prophesy. In 1 Timothy, it mentions, Timothy, don't forget what your mom and your grandma told you. They were the ones who were passing along the faith to a future pastor and helping train him for ministry. In Philippi, the church there, it met in Lydia's home. It talks about her as being a prominent business person. And whenever the church meets in someone's home in ancient Near East, as in first century times, that person was usually the leader of the church because they were the one that hosted and ran the events. So in whenever we're reading Philippians, you can picture that happening in Lydia's house, where she was the primary leader in that place. In Acts chapter 21, Philip has four daughters that were all prophets. And in fact, there's more female prophets in the New Testament than there are male prophets. In Romans chapter 16, which is an amazing chapter in the Bible, Phoebe is listed as a deacon and a fellow laborer of Paul. Priscilla and Aquila, they're a husband and wife. They oversaw a church in their home. And it says that both of them were in charge of training Apollos, who was one of the other famous teachers in the New Testament. So there you have a husband and wife team doing ministry together. And then I'll just end with this one. There's Romans chapter 16, verse 7, where Paul mentions Judea, which all scholars, I think, agree now is definitely a female name. Mentions her as outstanding among the apostles. So why in the world does 95% of the church say we can do this? It's heavy stuff, right? There's two verses that we should talk about because they're interesting. Paul writes this. First one is 1 Corinthians 14, where it says women should all be silent in church, for they are not permitted to speak and should remain silent. In 1 Timothy 2, it says, I do not permit a woman to teach or have authority over a man. She is to keep silent. One of the things that I've seen a lot of folks do is they'll take a Bible verse like that, and those are the only two that I really strongly know of that talk about women's role in church in the New Testament, outside of the ones I've read. And in those particular instances, one of the things that all Christians are called to do is interpret them and say, just like all the rest of them, and say, are these things that are meant to be done at all times and in all places? Or was this a cultural example of a thing that was right for that time and place? We don't know. So here's what I want to do. I just want to end with three different reasons why I think it is good to have women in ministry. Regarding those two verses, one of the things I would say about this is all Christians need to be smart readers of the Bible who understand the context and larger picture of the scripture story. For example, I'll use drinking as an example, because that's a controversial thing sometimes in churches. Every time I do a wedding here for a Baptist, a person who grew a Baptist, they never know whether or not they can drink at the reception. So what you do if you want to be a good Bible reader is you search from cover to cover, and you find different Bible verses to explain that topic. And so when it comes to drinking, here's a few of them. It says in Psalm 104 that David thanks God for wine because it made his heart glad. It says in Ephesians, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Debauchery is one of my favorite words. It's such a weird word, we don't use it anymore. Hibachi, the swirl there, I always call it debauchery because I don't like their food. Anyway, kind of dorky. The Apostle Paul encourages Timothy to drink wine for his stomach in one place in the New Testament. In Proverbs, it says wine is a mocker and beer is a brawler. This is like a fraternity, I think. Whoever is led astray by men is not wise. Jesus, we know in one instance in the Gospel of John, turns water into wine at a wedding, and someone says, you saved the best for last. You know that story. So a good Bible reader, what you do is you take all these texts, and you understand the context in which they came, and then when you pile them all together, you take a step back and you say, all right, now what is this saying to me? So a good interpreter of the Bible doesn't just take one little thing and say, I'm going to make that bigger than everything else. What you do is you take all of it, you read it as a whole, and you understand where it's all going, and then you try and put together a doctrine. So for alcohol, for me, based on all these texts, the assumption I get is alcohol can sometimes be good, but if you use too much and get drunk, it can cause problems. That doesn't seem crazy, right? So when it comes to women in ministry, a lot of folks I see take these two little verses from 1 Timothy and 1 Corinthians, and they say, oh, well, those are true in all times and all places, and everything else in the Bible doesn't matter regarding women. I recognize that different people can disagree with me, and that's okay. And you don't have to agree with me to be a part of this church, and that's all right, too. But I also know that there are reasons for what I believe, and I do my best to think through them with an open heart and an open mind. But one of the things that I think is really powerful and important for any Christian is to be open to the idea that God can change your mind about something. So what I'm asking you today is if you've never considered whether or not women should be in ministry, to maybe consider changing your mind on that topic. Second thing I want to talk about today is, so the first one is to be a smart reader of the Bible. I recognize you can't just take one idea, one little text, and use that to justify all kinds of things. One small example, I'll just throw this in for you, is slavery. For the bulk of Christian history, people thought slavery was ordained by God because you could find these small little verses here and there to justify the practice of slavery. Now, I don't know any Christian today who would say that that's a proper interpretation of the Bible. Our minds changed, and that's an okay thing. And I'll also say one of the things we come to realize, and this gets to my second point, is that the grand arc of Scripture, the main story of Scripture, isn't about enslavement, but instead about becoming a more inclusive community. This is a bold statement, but I think the grand arc of the story of the Bible is to show how far and how deep and how wide God's love can extend to all kinds of people. Now, I don't mean that God's okay with it. That's not what I'm saying. But what I am saying is that the folks that we think shouldn't be, God more often than not says, you have no idea how I can love you. So when I read the Bible, one of the things that we see first off is you see Abraham. And Abraham was the first person that was really called by God, by a person, in Genesis chapter 12. And when he finds Abraham, he says, Abraham, I'm going to bless you, and you're going to be mine. Your descendants are going to be like the stars of the sky, the sand on the seashore. And I'm going to bless you so that you will be a blessing to other people. In other words, God acts in your life and calls you and blesses you, not for your own sake, and so that you can share that love with other people and invite more people to be a part of God's story. In the New Testament, there was this huge debate. And if you think the Bible is in the New Testament, you'd just be more like them. These folks fought all the time in the New Testament. And one time they had a huge fight where they had to call a congregational meeting. They called a council in Jerusalem where all the elders and all the people showed up. And it was this big contentious issue. Do you know what the number one issue was to these early Christians? The early Christians thought, that this was just for the Jewish people, that Jesus came to teach them how to be better Jews, but it wasn't necessarily for everybody else. The Jews represented about 1% of the population at this time. And so Jesus came as a Jew among Jewish people, but the debate was, is he here for us, or is he for other people too? And that was the huge fight. It was a racial and ethnic debate about who could be included in God's covenant people. The Jews said, well, we've been his covenant people forever. Why would that doesn't make any sense, and how would that work? To the Gentiles who convert, do they have to get circumcised, do they have to go through all the Jewish rules that we go through? I will tell you this, if it were required me to be circumcised and I wasn't as an adult to become a Christian, I wouldn't do it. That would just be too much, Jesus. I'll bend to my cross, but anyway, my point is this, is they have this big debate on who could be included and what was going to be required, you know what they decided? Let them in. I don't know how this is going to work. We're going to say, all right, don't be strangled by idols, and don't, like, go crazy on another. Basically, they had a couple small things, but basically, at the end of the day, they said, all right, God's love is somehow bigger than we can dream or imagine, and we're going to find a way to live together in harmony and unity. You and I would not be here today if in the first century, in the early part of the church, they had made that decision. There's maybe a few Jews that are here among us who are ethnically Jewish. But I know I wouldn't be here if they hadn't decided to open the gates. A healthy church is one that has that spirit inside of it. It isn't primarily one that puts borders and boundaries between people, but it's one that breaks down borders and breaks down walls to find anyone. One of my favorite stories about Jesus is he said there were 100 sheep and 99 were here, but one was lost. And you know what Jesus was willing to do? He was willing to leave the 99 and go find the one that was lost because his heart is to seek and to save the lost. And they were willing to break down any barrier or wall in order to get them. Do you see what I'm saying? I'm saying that the overall arc and trajectory of Scripture is one of radical inclusion into God's people. And that changes things. It means it's not an in crowd. It's not a group of people that think that they've got it all together and everything figured out. It's a group of lost people that have been found whose job is to go find them. So, be a smart reader of the Bible. Understand that the grand arc of Scripture leads to a more and radical inclusivity. And the last one I'll say is this, is the testimony of the Holy Spirit. So Billy Graham's second child, his daughter, Aunt Graham Watts. I was listening to a story that she told one time, and she felt called to ministry. She watched her dad run for years, and so she ended up becoming a famous evangelist as well. But at one of the events that she went to, she was preaching the gospel. And picture a crowd bigger than this. All the men in the audience prior to her preaching had agreed that what they would do is when she started speaking, they would take their chairs and turn around and turn their backs on her. And so, you know, she'd never quite dealt with this before. And what she did is she decided she better go home and figure stuff out. And so she went home and she started reading the scriptures. She said, God, I got to figure this out because if I'm doing something wrong, I need to know. All these people feel like I'm not supposed to be doing it. What should I do? And she read the story of all the prophets, especially Jeremiah. And there's this wonderful story in Jeremiah where he says, God, I don't really want to do this. This is hard to share the gospel. Like, people are going to judge me, and it's going to be difficult, and I'm not going to be liked. Like, what should I do? And God says, your job is not to preach the gospel to make them happy. You do it because you're obedient to me and what I've called you to do. Our primary responsibility is to ask God first and let him confirm that in our heart. The Protestant church wouldn't be here. Martin Luther had decided just to go with the rules and didn't listen to the Holy Spirit and to God's word. And so the role of the Holy Spirit to confirm things in your heart is an important way in which God does new things and speaks new things into our life today. I remember a weird moment in my life. I was sitting in a class as a senior in college, and it was a class on Paul, because I studied New Testament and Old Testament back in those days. And I'm in class, and I remember the professor raises his hand and says, so, given that we just read 1 Timothy 2, you know, how many of you, what's a good argument for women in ministry? And I was always that kid in class that sat in the back row that never raised my hand. I was that kid. Like, I was barely paying attention at best. But for some reason that day, I raised my hand and got called on. And I remember just this moment of shock, like, in my life, I'm like, oh crap, I'm participating. You know, like, okay. And I remember, for some reason in my heart, I just said, well, you know, like, the scripture may say that, but I feel like I've seen women do this, and when I see them do this, God's working. That's been my experience. And so it's okay to admit that in our experience, sometimes we see things that maybe we don't understand in the scriptures, and for me, that was the case. One of the worst arguments I've heard for why women shouldn't be in ministry is because sometimes you might see a woman who preaches and you don't like the sermon. That's an okay argument for why that person may or may not be in ministry. There's a lot of men who preach terrible sermons, too. And you're going to have to apply that logic both ways. In fact, some of you are like, how did you get here, right? I mean, they can be really tricky. Last thing I'll say is this on this topic, and this is such a huge topic, and I recognize people can disagree on this, and that's okay. But one of the things that is new to me as a dad is I have a daughter. And it changes things when you have a daughter, because when you look down at her, you don't want to tell her in advance what she can and can't do. There's something just this infinite potential that exists within a human being. And I will say this, I don't believe in the word equality very much. I don't think God calls people to equality. What's foundational in our midst is whether or not the Holy Spirit is gifting and empowering someone to do ministry. It's the Holy Spirit that calls someone into it, not us. So, like, when it comes to making quotas in our church for how many men or women we have on every committee, that's not our primary criteria by which we would judge anything. I'm totally okay with if we have way more women or way more men in a different area based on what we feel like God is doing in our midst. But I will say this, that if there's a woman, and I know there's many, I have many friends who feel called by God to preach the gospel, they look equipped to do so, and when they do so, people respond in faith and with passion to follow Christ in many different ways. One of the saddest things that you can see is saying, we're going to make a human rule that says you can't do that anymore. Man, that would be fun. I think it's okay to be told no. I get told no all the time. Whenever I say, hey, I want to go do this thing, really smart people say, Chris, you can't go do that. That's stupid. And that's an okay thing. But whenever you're told no, when you feel called by God to go do something, that's a whole different situation. And I would just encourage you, for those of you that are women, that feel called to be a part of church leadership or proclaiming the gospel in any way, if that fire is burning in your heart, do not. You guys can tell this is personal. Half of the human race is pushed out for sin. And on Mother's Day, I apologize, guys. But my hope and my prayer is that our church can be a place where everyone feels safe and called as God calls them to unleash the spiritual gifts that God's given them in whatever way it comes. And if we mess up, and we do, it's okay, forgive us. But hopefully we can be a part of what God's doing, this new creation in the new part, where women are empowered to be the ones who go first. And that's okay. We pray for them.
That's the cold, you know? It's the cold.
God, we just thank you so much for the ways that you open our eyes and open our hearts. We thank you for when you came to earth, that you came to show us a new way, not to confirm our broken paths, but to instead build new stones for us to walk on, stones for you. And so help us as a church to be the kind of community where every spiritual gift of every person is lifted up so that they can be used to glorify you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, so now we have some work to do. If you turn your bulletin to page 8.